Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk about the structure of music from a mathematical point of view. So I want to introduce some thinking which allows us to zoom out from the usual cultural, historical approach to writing music, naming music, naming notes, naming chords, and think a little bit more about the large-scale mathematical structure and how we can use that perhaps to clarify some things and maybe actually even make it easier to think about music in a broader way. So we're going to be basing things on this 12-tone chromatic scale that we've talked about, and I remind you that that's mathematically resting on these equal ratios between these adjacent notes. Each of these intervals, okay, represents a ratio of frequencies, and that ratio of frequencies is the same for each one of these steps, okay? And that ratio has the property that if we raise it to the 12th power, then we go from, we get to 2, because that's corresponding to the octave, which is the relationship between these two notes. Now, this actually is not exactly the way the Pythagoreans thought about things. It's a more sophisticated way in some sense, but it does contain some irrationality in that there actually is no exact number which has the property that when you raise it to the 12th power, you get 2. So there is no 12th root of 2. That's just the way the world is. And we can accept that, or we can perhaps try to deny it, but it's best if we accept it and just admit that that's an approximate construction, right? So this well-tempered scale is necessarily something approximate. There's no instrument on the planet which has an exact well-tempered scale. Okay, so having said that, we do want to transcend the usual orientation in Western music to the major scale, the C major scale. And we also want to step back from this naming convention that currently is very piano focused. Okay, so the current naming convention is C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. And the black notes get names that depend on the adjacent white notes. And there's two of them, right? So this one here is just a little bit above C, so that's C sharp, or it's a little bit below the D, so it's D flat. So each of these black notes actually has two names, sort of in different contexts. That makes the whole thing rather a little bit cumbersome, although the architecture of the piano is brilliant, okay? It's really great because the placing of the black keys makes it obvious where the interval is. So, I mean, you can easily see that's a C because it's to the left of the two black notes. And so this note here, which is also to the left of the two black notes, is also a C, as is this one, etc., okay? So it makes navigation and hence playing on the piano relatively easy. But it does come with this rather cumbersome notation, which doesn't really, logically translate to a guitar or a stringed instrument or a wood instrument, very, very naturally. So what we want to do today is think about a purely mathematical way of doing that. And it's kind of obvious. I mean, anybody who sort of asks himself, how are we going to do this, is likely going to come up with the same answer, okay? So here's the answer. That what we're going to do is we're going to describe these notes going from here to here, which are in this sequence of 12 steps, with the numbers 0 to 11. We could do 1 to 12, but in many counting situations, as computer scientists well know, it's better to start with 0. So we're going to start with 0 here. Okay, that's going to be note 0. Note 1, note 2, note 3, note 4, note 5, note 6, note 7, note 8, note 9, note 10, note 11, and then back up here, well, that's note 12, but if we're only sort of interested in the tone, if we're sort of equating this note with this note, then we could also call that 0 and start our naming again. If we didn't want to do that, if we wanted to maintain the distinction between this note and this note, well, that's simple enough. We just call this one 0 and this one 12. This one then would be 24. This would be 36. What about this one here? Well, that would have to be minus 12. So, of course, this convention depends on the starting note, the 0 note, okay? And in principle, the zero starting note could be anywhere. And that's one of the beautiful aspects of this from a mathematical point of view, that there's an intrinsic translation symmetry here. There's actually some group theory, okay, which is actually quite interesting, that's supporting this musical structure. And one of the aspects of that is that it's translation invariant. So for example, if we wanted to start with F, okay, as the zero note, we could do that. We could say, okay, that's note zero, that's note 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and then 12, or perhaps zero. Okay, so this is a very flexible method, and it leads to some interesting insights and notational simplifications, I think, sometimes, for chords, which are sort of the building blocks of harmony in music. Okay, so let's go back to starting at C. This note C, which now we're going to call this note zero, okay? Now usually we start with middle C. This particular C is sort of the central C, but I'm just going to do it down here because it's a little bit easier in terms of the camera, okay? So this is going to be zero. And what about the other main notes? Well, we've talked about the importance of the fourth and the fifth in traditional notation, but now we see that the fourth has this alternate name, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's actually note 5 in this sequential ordering of the notes. And the fifth is actually note 7 in this sequential ordering. So we have this note is the note 5, this note is note 7. Another important one is the third, well, that's going to be note 4. The minor third is 3. And the 6 is 2 above the 7 is 9. So let's just get used to that, just to get our heads around this, okay? 3, 4, 5, 7, 9. Those are, you know, very important notes in the scale of C. Although actually the 3 is not actually in the scale, it's in the minor scale. Great. Okay, so now we have notes, we could get familiar with those notes. And now we can talk about intervals, okay? So the intervals relationship between two notes. So let's say between this note and this note. Well, it's obvious what that is. That's an interval of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have to take 5 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, to get from the start to the end, okay? So we could say that's an interval of step 5. That makes sense? But that relative aspect can be applied to any two notes in principle here in this range. So let's say we want to go from E to this A, okay? Well, that's also a 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's a 5 chord or 5 step interval. The perfect fifth we said was a 7th, okay? So this is also a step 7 interval. This is a step 7 interval. This is a step 7 interval. And if you didn't know that, of course, if you play the piano a lot, you learn that this is a perfect fifth. You learn that, you know, if you go a perfect fifth up from the E, you get B. Okay, it's sort of automatic eventually. But if you didn't know, and you just remember that the name of this note is 4 and the name of this note is 11, then you could calculate the interval just with a bit of mathematics. Because 11 minus 4 is 7. So you see, the mathematical structure, the way we set this thing up, makes it easier to describe relationships between notes also mathematically. So we free ourselves from the C, E sharp, A flat, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So, okay, that's great. So now, so then we have these important intervals, which really correspond to the notes, like that's a major third, okay? That's a step 4 chord. Perfect fourth is a step 5 chord, and a perfect fifth is a step 7 chord. Sixth is, major 6 is a step 9 chord. Okay? There are others, but those are the main ones. I guess also the minor third is very important. That's a step 3. So step 3, step 4, step 5, step 7, step 9. Okay, great. So what do we do after we've understood intervals? Well, we put them together to form chords. And the smallest chords are triads involving three notes, say those three notes, usually called C, E, and G. And that's a major triad. And it sounds presumably the same as, say, this one. That's another major triad, but starting on this note here. Here's another major triad. Okay, so we can analyze the major triad because it really consists of two intervals. So from here to here is from 0 to 4. That's a major third from 0 to 4. And then from 4 to 7, that's a difference of 3. Okay, so that's a minor third. Okay, so the major chord consists of a major third followed by a minor third. Or we would say a step 4 interval followed by a step 3 interval. So we could say that this chord is described by the numbers 4 and 3, the steps that we have to take to get from one note to the next. It's a step 4-3 chord. Okay, what's the step 4-3 chord starting on there? Okay, 1-2-3-4, that's the step 4. And then we have to go step 3, 1-2-3, that's up to there. So that is the major chord on this note here. And what is this note here? This one? Well, this is one that's actually exactly halfway between the original note and the octave 12. This note here, this F sharp, it's usually called, is note 6. Between the perfect fourth and between the perfect fifth, which is the number, note 5 and note 7. So note 6 is exactly halfway in between. So these kind of mathematical sensitivities are going to be more important for us now. We're sort of maybe alert to this kind of thing. Okay, what's next after a major chord? Well, probably the minor triad, okay? The minor triad is the variation where you replace the major third here with a minor third. So instead of going 4-3, we're going 3-4. That's step 3, 1-2-3, and from here to here is a step 4, 1-2-3-4. And in terms of the notes, that's 0, that's 3, that's 7. So the differences are 3 and 4. 0 to 3 to 7 is a 3-4 chord or triad. That's a minor triad. So suppose we wanted to start it on here. Okay, so that'll get us extended up beyond the original scale, but that's fine. So if we do a minor triad there, we get this. Okay. So in terms of numbers, this would be 8, 9, 10, 11, and then four more, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, that's sort of interesting here, right? So if we just kept on linearly going, this would be 15. But this is the same as this note, which is a 3, 1, 2, 3. So there is a repetitive aspect to this. Every 12, it repeats. So this note here, we could give it the same name as this one if we want to sort of just look at the tone of it and disregard its position. But if we want to put the position in as well, then this is maybe 3 and this is then 15. And there's a difference of 12 between them. Okay, that's an octave. And so going back to this minor triad that I built up from this note number 8, we went 8, 11, 15. Step 3, followed by step 4. Now there's two other triads, which I'll just finish with, that are commonly used. One is the augmented triad. We take a major triad and augment that one there. Okay, so what does that consist of? Well, it consists of this interval, which is a what kind of interval? Well, it's a four-step, classically known as a major third. Well, we can say it's a four-step. And from here to here, that's another four-step. So this triad is a 4-4 chord, or step 4-4 chord. That's called an augmented chord. It's a little bit an unusual chord. Okay. We could build it on lots of things. Okay. And then there's correspondingly a diminished chord, which is this one, just a diminished triad, I should say, okay, because there's only three notes here, okay, and this is note 0, note 3, and note six. Remember that six there? Okay. 0, 3, 6. And obviously that's step 3-3. A minor third followed by another minor third. And of course we can build that anywhere. So we could build it, say, on this A, there, 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 or on this E. Maybe we should call this note 4, right? So we're going up 3, from 4 to 7 to 10. So the numerals that we're assigning to these notes helps us in, you know, quickly saying something about the relative positions of them. And happily, this entire story translates, and this is the crucial, you know, part of the symmetry here, it translates when we just move up and base our scale not on C but on some other note. So, for example, if we started on F, okay, then that would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, so if we wanted to build a diminished chord on that, in terms of referring to this as 0, okay, it's still going to be a 3-3 step chord. So it's going to go up 3, there's 3, and another 3, there's another 3. So there's the diminished chord built on 0 in the scale that's starting or referenced to this particular note. So the absolute names of the notes then become less important, and the relative names of the notes become more important, especially with reference to a fixed sort of tonic or starting point, which was the zero note. Okay, but of course the standard default, although there are many scales, usually all beginners start with the C scale. Maybe not in terms of learning piano, but you know, it's visually the easiest, and so that's perhaps the default zero. Although I'm starting down here, but that would probably be the default zero if you were looking at the entire piano. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.